Welcome to episode 9 of the Heritage Llangwm podcast. I'm Heather Payton. This month, what we really found at the dig all is revealed, and reliving the past, how one man lost 3 stone in as many minutes. If you came to our Meet the Experts event last month, you'll have heard our tame archaeologist James Meek on the results of the dig at Great Nash Farm in April. What we were looking for, of course, was remnants of Flemish culture left behind by Llangwm's 12th century founders. And we did find some medieval pottery, of which more later. However, potentially even more exciting were reminders of a far earlier culture, flints, which it was thought at the time were from the Mesolithic period, so between 5,000 and 12,000 years old. James has since had them analysed with some fascinating results, which, as well as giving an insight into how our Stone Age ancestors lived, also tell us a lot about how archaeologists work.
We've passed them under the nose of Andrew David, who, formerly of English Heritage, who is very much a flint expert, has done an awful lot of work in off flint in Pembrokeshire. And he is fairly convinced that with the types of the material we're getting and the actual flint itself, that it's late Mesolithic. The material we're getting out is typically blade flakes. Now, they do run late Mesolithic into the early Neolithic as well. But associated with that, we've also had these things that are called microliths, which are very small fragments of flint. They are worked and actually created into small shape. I mean, some of them are called scalene, gives an idea. They're little sort of almost triangular, very thin, very pointy bits. Now, they would have been used in to have then been inserted into wood, like spearheads or harpoons, you know, and those individual bits of flint are then used in conjunction with lots of others to create the tool that they're after. We also had a couple of interesting long stone pebbles, beveled pebbles, that on site we kept them because we were fairly certain they must be something to do with this Mesolithic flint, but we weren't 100% sure, and giving them to Andrew David, instantly thought that yes, they were probably pebbles brought, collected probably because of their shape. They're quite long and thin, probably with an end knocked off just to make them fairly flat on the one end, and then those would have been used in the manufacture of the flint tools.
So these people were hunter-gatherers, obviously. Does that mean, would this have been a settlement? Would it have been somewhere where they went seasonally, or what?
Well, potentially it's a seasonal site, but I was just chatting to somebody earlier on and made me think that what we got in conjunction with this was we were finding bits of hazelnut shell. Now, that might mean, you know, they sat down for a single meal and it just happened to comprise hazelnuts and off they went. But actually, looking at the material, and I'd say from this small area, we've got an awful lot of bladelets, shall we say, but they're not from the same piece of flint. So it's not one person sitting there with one nodule of flint, knocking 6 bells out of it or 7 bells out of it and then creating a single tool. These are obviously, you know, laid down from quite a period of working. Now, whether that means they were there for one season, but we're talking about months of settlement, possibly, or alternatively, they, as you say, they could well have been returning there every year, but it's certainly not just one event with one flint nodule and one person napping a bit and off they go. This seems to be a more prolonged usage site.
This site, of course, was a fair way inland, and another Mesolithic site, also in Llangwm, was found much nearer the coast. What does all of that tell us?
Admittedly, the other site seemed to be somewhat earlier, so we are talking of thousands of years apart. But I mean, certainly with the other site at Llangwm, that's nearer the coast and it's more typical of the sort of Mesolithic flint scatters as have been found throughout Pembrokeshire. They seem to be following watercourses, or they seem to be on the coastal edge. What we're finding now with a lot of other, well, with the more sites that we're looking at, is we are finding Mesolithic sites inland, away from any obvious major river source or, you know, the main watercourses, should we say. And certainly the one at Great Nash, that seems to be, well, unlike the typical sites, somewhat atypical. It's inland, it's on a hilltop, definite, again, seasonal occupation site. It's just showing us there are so many more of those sites out there which we don't get the opportunity to look at. And that's one of the reasons why Great Nash has been excellent, you know, for two reasons. Well, you know, with lots of medieval pottery, but then to find this undisturbed Mesolithic site hidden underneath, you know, buried, sealed underneath, which I say quite often we wouldn't get the opportunity to look at. So it's adding to our knowledge of the Mesolithic in Pembrokeshire. It's excellent, yeah.
During the dig, we got very excited because we found lots of medieval fragments of pots, and some quite big ones, in fact. Now, you've actually had those analysed, haven't you?
The general thought with the pottery is that the majority of the wares that we're getting are, as we thought on site, these things called Dyved gravel tempered wares, which are probably locally made vessels, cooking pots. They're not the posh cookware, you know, it's not the stuff that you only get out for Sunday best. These are your utilitarian stuff. It's the cooking pots. It's the stuff that when it gets broken, it's heaped out on the midden, and they just go and purchase another one. Seems to be at Great Nash. We've got an awful lot of those cooking pots, which is good. You know, it's showing kitchens. It's showing that they had a certain amount of wealth at the house, as we would have anticipated. But also there are the occasional sherd we've been finding of the posher stuff, the material that's been imported in, the glazed material, ham green stuff from Bristol area, which is probably quite early as well. And I mean, all the pottery we're getting, the majority of this material is dating from probably the later 1200s through to the later 1400s. So there may be a bit of material that even predates the De La Roches, but with the way the pottery is dated, it's more, or could have just been carried on being in use till Great Nash was actually set up.
But nothing that we can say this was brought in from Flanders, ideally, but across the Channel.
No, there was no material that we could say has come from the continent. But again, we have only dug a tiny part of that site, and so the material we've got is only limited to what we've seen in the trench. With the other material we've got, you know, there's obviously a lot more there to be found. So there is still a potential, it's there. It's just unfortunately in our trenches we put in this year, we haven't found it.
James Meek of Dyved Archaeological Trust and his dig diary remains on the Trust's website, showing all of us amateur archaeologists at work. One of the star events at Llangwm's recent carnival was the pageantry and sheer fun provided by Lanska Reenactment. To the casual observer, they appear to be a group of people who spend their time charging around on horses while pretending to be characters from history. That's doing them a grave disservice, of course. It's much more complicated than that, as you'll hear in a moment. As well as being stars of the carnival, they'll also be starring in the film of our research project currently being put together, which gave me an excuse to go along one day earlier this year to watch them practice. Will you join me on a hilltop in rural Carmarthenshire, a very windy hilltop? Seven members of the group, on horseback and in costume, are running, galloping through their routines under the eye of a trainer. And here, discipline is the watchword. These horses are big. And to an outsider, some of the moves look challenging, to say the least. Their trainer needs to know what she's doing. If you're dropping back and you see the horses going forward, push them on, okay? Time to find out more.
My name's Carrie Harris and I'm a part of Lanska Reenactment, which is a sister group of Regia Angelorum.
Carrie, we heard you shouting at him a moment ago. You sort of play the part of the Sergeant Major, don't you?
I'd say more riding instructor. Okay. We are training at drill riding. Not all of our riders here today have done it before or frequently. So it's just a case of reminding them that they are to stay in line abreast and to encourage them to push on their horses when they need to.
And it's actually quite serious stuff because these are big horses, aren't they?
They are indeed. Our largest horse here today is 16.3 and our smallest is 14.2. That's done in hands high and each hand is 4 inches.
So they look, I mean, I know nothing about this, but they look to me like they're pretty expert at what they're doing, the riders. Are they?
Some are, some aren't. We have got riders here from novice level right up to very skilled and experienced riders. So I'm glad they all looked good.
They certainly did that. And how many have you got in the group altogether?
I think our local branch of Lanska has 15 members, although they're not all horse riders. We have members here today from all over the country, representing many different local groups of the larger Regia Angelorum Radfolk riding group.
This is a training day today. How often do you Do you do all of this?
We try and train for the equestrian event at least twice a year. We are training here today in Wales with the Welsh Horse Yeomanry, and we have another base where we go to in Yorkshire with Mark Atkinson. We try and get together as often as we can.
And what does that turn out to be? Every weekend, every month, what?
Because we are quite spread across the country, getting everybody together is quite difficult. So we do train twice a year, and then we usually have two or three or more equine displays at shows each year as well.
I was looking at the costumes, and everyone, of course, is in costume. Everyone who's on a horse, you are not, but everyone else is. How authentic are the costumes? I mean, how much attention do you pay to detail on that?
Regular Anglorum particularly prides itself on its authenticity. So all of the clothing that you see here has been handmade by members with fabrics and in the colours and weaves that would have been around in the period. A lot of time is spent in research and testing and dyeing to see if we can recreate these colours and fabrics that we use.
So do you use old-fashioned traditional dyeing methods as well?
Some do. A lot of the fabric you see here will be modern dyed, but we have got some dyers within the society that do recreate our own fabrics.
And I always ask this because it's fascinating to know, what do you do the rest of the time? What's your day job?
I'm a full-time mother, but I'm also a riding instructor. So you'd be fascinated, actually. It is very interesting to find out what the reenactors do. My husband works in the medical equipment manufacturer. We've got teachers, lawyers, right down to the unemployed.
Well, I'm going to go and talk to your husband, Mike. I'm not quite sure if I can reach him because he's sitting on top of a rather large horse, but I'll see how I go. Thanks.
No problem.
Can I reach you? So that's the helmet off, and that's that looks heavy. Is that heavy?
It is very heavy. Yes, it's all of the equipment that you see, all of the military armor that you see Mike wearing today adds approximately 3 stone to his weight.
Can you feel that? Is that exhausting to wear that?
It's fine when you first put it on. After you spend a couple of hours in it, it starts to drag down on your hips and your shoulders.
Yeah.
But we only wear it for a couple of hours a day at our events, but back then it would have been a very regular thing for men to wear this all day, even if they weren't on campaign.
And tell me, apart from the helmet, tell me what you've got on.
Currently I have got a Haubergen on, which is a long mail shirt comprised of approximately 40,000 steel links, all interwoven. It weighs about 2¾ stone, so it can be felt. Underneath this would be a padded gambeson, which can be made up of 30 to 50 layers of linen, which would basically be there to absorb any sort of percussive force from a shot coming in from a sword or an axe. And then under that would just be my normal everyday dress. It would be my linen and wool tunics.
And tell me a bit more about the chainmail. Am I correct in calling this chainmail?
It's kind of a nickname that it has been is given, because of course it's not made of anything resembling the chain. It's just the pattern that is given to it. In medieval references, it's called mail, which is spelled M-A-I-L-L-E.
And it's all bits of metal linked together. How do you do that? I mean, you've made that yourself, haven't you?
Yes. You can buy the individual links, and it's a fairly simple pattern of 4 into 1, what we call a flower pattern, where you have a central link interconnected to 4 other links, and then you just repeat the pattern to build up lines. And from that, you can make up squares of mail, which you join together. When you get enough panels, you basically start building up the body and then the arms. And depending on how long you want it, how short, it can range between, and also the size of the man, it can range between anywhere between 25 to 60,000 links.
And how long do you reckon this would have taken you to make?
I've seen somebody make one in 2 weeks, flat, but it's all that they did. But back then, I mean, this was an expensive piece of kit. You would have had to have gone to a specialist blacksmith to get this, and they would have had to have individually made every link before it's been constructed. So, and back then, the steel for a male shirt was very, very expensive and very rare. So it was very time consuming to put together. So you can look anywhere between 6 months to a year to fully complete one.
And you very kindly made a Delaroche shield with the three fishes on it.
I did. Yes. When we got involved with this project, Pamela Hunt gave us a lot of information about the Delaroche family. In particular, the coat of arms for the Delaroche family. So I took it upon myself. I already had a heater shield, which is a short shield, which everybody is familiar with if they think of King John and William Marshall, and basically did my research on the coat of arms and painted it as such.
It looks terrific. What I know that you all make your own kit, and it's very impressive, that is too, but there is quite an industry that's grown up around Reenactment Group, isn't there?
Yes, over the last 10 to 15 years, historical reenactment in the country has really taken off. The society we belong to has been going for 30 plus years, and is one of the largest and probably most accurate early medieval historical societies in the country. I mean, we've got an average of 700 active members. We've got groups in South Africa, the United States, and currently groups are forming on the continent in Spain. So, blacksmiths, leather workers, pottery specialists, anything that was involved in a medieval everyday craft is now being replicated on a very, very high production level to support this hobby.
Mike Harris of Lanska Reenactment, and if you're quick, you can catch them at Kilgerran Castle on Sunday the 7th of August. That's it for now. We've been putting together the app that will communicate with the tapestry when it goes on show, so we hope to bring you some news about that next month. Thanks as ever to the Heritage Lottery Fund for making Heritage Llangwm possible. And until next month, thanks to you for listening.